First, apologies from Karen, who couldn't be here. My other collaborator is sitting down here, but I'd give this talk. And of course, the other member of this team is William of Ockham, who I think you must agree is the best dressed member of the of these teams. Unfortunately, died about 800 years ago, but he was a very interesting chap. He was a Franciscan monk who disproved all the standard proofs of God, which was a somewhat dodgy thing to do back in the 13th century. So he was accused of heresy and was taken to Avignon, where the Pope was. And there he accused the Pope of being a heretic and had to flee Avignon with the papal soldiers on his tail. But what he's most famous for, of course, is this line. What's known as Ockham's razor. Entities shall not be multiplied beyond necessity. In other words, if you have competing explanations of a phenomenon, and one involves fewer entities, fewer pieces, if you like, than another, then choose the simplest. It's been a very extraordinarily powerful principle applied very much in physics. For instance, Newton. Let's have a look at Newton's famous laws about every action should have an equal and opposite reaction. Well, you could make an alternative law. Every action should have an equal and opposite reaction plus a small demon pushing at the other side of an object. And you can make another law and have two demons. And another law, three demons, etc. And all laws are really like that. You can add other bits to them and they just still will account for your data. They will still make sense, but what? Newton said, to this purpose, the philosophers, like Ockham, say that nature does nothing in vain, and more is in vain when less will serve. For nature is pleased with simplicity and affects not the pomp of superfluous causes. So that's been a very important principle throughout the development of physics. But does it have applications in the field which I'm dealing with? Biology. And this guy, Hans Westerhoff, claims that it doesn't. He wrote this paper a few years ago now, but he came and gave a talk here in which he's made the claim that there is no Ockham's razor in biology because biology is irreducibly complex. Biological systems are so complex they can't be reduced in any sensible way. So there's no way of looking for simpler solutions, and you shouldn't do it. Forget Ockham's razor if you want to study biology. Okay, now why I was interested in this when Hans came here and gave a talk is that we do have a local interest in William of Ockham, because Ockham's only down the road. He's a local hero. So you may remember that some of our some of the area on the other side of the A3, we have Ockham Road, named after William of Ockham. So he's a local chap, so I thought I ought to defend his honour and his razor. And here's one way of looking at why I think we need Ockham's razor. And here's a simple question. How many dogs are behind the fence? Okay, obviously looks like there's one dog. Clear enough. But there could be two dogs. Two possible explanations for the same set of data. So how many dogs are behind the fence? Both sets of data are, both hypotheses, both models are perfectly compatible with the data. It could be one dog or it could be two dogs. Now when you've got those competing models, which do you choose? On what criteria would you choose one dog or two dogs? Well, there is a kind of criteria that we can use. You can consider it by looking at where is the head and where is the tail. Now, if you have one dog, when you have a head here, you'll have a tail there. But if you have two dogs, you can have the head and the tail anywhere you like. So the two-dog model encompasses more variable states. It will allow different data sets, a more varied form of data sets than the one dog model. And this is a feature of all simple models. They make sharper predictions. And that's what's always been a very powerful feature of the argument for simplicity. You can kind of consider that, that if you consider a data set having two axes, then a complex model will encompass a wide variety of possible data points, whereas a simple model may encompass only a small possible set of data points. Now, if your data comes in and it happens to sit along this line, it's equally compatible with both models, but which is the more probable? It's clearly this one is the more probable, because you kind of see it obviously. If really this model was around, was the correct one, these points should be over the, all over the place, so why, how come they're all sitting along this line? It kind of argues it should be this model, but how do you put that into a mathematical instantiation? And this is what the project was about. And we chose another chap in a frock, the Reverend Bayes, to help us with our argument and his famous equation on this t-shirt. There he is up there. And you can use a version of his equation to compare different models. And the key part of this comparison is this component over here. I won't go into the details of this, but basically this component here is the probability of data given your model. And these are two competing models, H1 and H2, to explain any set of data, for instance, whether there's one or two dogs. And this is then asking, now you've seen the data, say the two dogs being in the same place, what is the probability of that data given your model? And you can derive a ratio of those, and that gives you something with a little bit of manipulation, equivalent what's called an Ockham factor, which can be used to compare different models and perhaps choose the simplest one. So this is very important in biology, so I believe, because biology can start off with a simple system, but if Hans Westhoff is right, well, you shouldn't be really using that simple system. There's more to it than that. And in fact, there's a lot more to it than that. And this is biochemical pathways. And it's just one aspect of biology. If you start with a simple system, you can always add in and more complexity onto it. So what we are claiming then is that when you have a data set, there are always multiple explanations, and particularly in biology, because the system is so complex. And you need the razor to cut them down. And we explored that by looking at a simple situation. We have two models. A simple model, I can see my sand is running out, so I'm going to have to speed up. Simple model in which A converts to C, B to D, or a more complex one in which you can have these interconversions. Now, you can generate data from these models, putting some, say, radioactive tracer in this system, comes out here, it doesn't come out there. So you can measure this, and you should get these kind of values. And you could say, okay, if I get this, choose a simple model. If I get this, choose a complex model. That doesn't always work because of noise. Noise means that even this one will sometimes be noisy and will give you some gray as well. And if you have that noise, it tends to make you, if you use the standard statistical tools, choose the more complex model because it will fit the noise. So, what we did then was simulate data on a simple metabolic system like this using a simple model. You made a model, generated data, simulated, and then used standard statistical tools to look at whether the simple model accounts for the data or the more complex. This is now using standard chi-squared test, Pearson up there who invented the test, and this shows the area where the standard system gets it wrong. It chooses the complex model despite the fact that the simple one was the correct one. Here's Ockham, and it only gets it wrong over here. So in other words, if we use Ockham's razor as a statistical test, we will choose the correct model when the correct model is the simple model more often. So that's it. Thank you very much.